I give honor to all of the mothers in the house today and that are virtual. I give honor to those who want to be mothers, my God. Those who have the gift but have not been able to bear children. It's a hard day for them too. I give honor to those whose mothers who've passed away, grandmothers who've gone on to be with the Lord. And we're thankful that our mothers' souls were anchored, because that gives us just a little bit of comfort to let us know that they're resting in the arms of Jesus. I won't be before you long. I want to say a few names. I like to say the names of some of the mothers in my life, because I think if you say their name, you keep their spirit and memories alive. And so I say the name of Lillian Travis, my maternal grandmother. I say the name of Celestine Simmons, my paternal grandmother. I say my mother's name, Kay Simmons, who is on virtually. She's actually here in Memphis, but was not able to be in the service because she's only had that one dose of the vaccine. And so I ask that you might pray with her. And I say the name of Darlene Moore, my mother in love. Amen. That's Michael's mom. She called me this morning, and she was talking at first, and then she started praying. You know how mamas do. They start out talking, and then they start talking to the Lord, and you just get to closing your eyes because you know it's a prayer. And so she prayed for me this morning. And so it's good to have people that might call you and say a word of prayer that might encourage you this morning. And so I am thankful. Why don't you turn with me in your Bibles to Habakkuk chapter 3, starting at verse 17. Habakkuk, that's in the Old Testament. Habakkuk chapter 3, starting with verse 17. And I'll be reading the NIV. That's Habakkuk. I'll give you some time to find it. Those of you who are at home who have your devices, Habakkuk chapter 3, starting at verse 17. And it reads, "Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in my God, my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of deer. He enables me to tread on the heights." And for the moment that are ours, our title for this morning's message is In the Meantime. In the meantime, let us pray. Oh God, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. God, we are so thankful for your presence today. And now, God, we ask that you might hide me behind your cross. I don't want them to see me, but all of you, God, preach with power and conviction. God, preach with boldness. It is in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. In the meantime, everybody has a meantime experience. Everybody has some life experience that may lead them to the meantime. Immediate satisfaction is not giving. Having things work out aren't always a given in life. No, there are times in our lives where we are waiting, where the God of the universe presses pause on our program, and we find ourselves in a place waiting. It happens to the best of us. No matter our race, creed, color, or pedigree, we can find ourselves in the meantimes of life. And this is true for mothers as we celebrate today. Mothers who are called to nurture young lives. Mothers who step up when others are not willing or unable. Mothers who give too much of themselves for the success and greatness of others. Yes, mothers can find themselves in the meantimes of life. the meantime. This is an in-between time. It's unexpected and unplanned, and most of the time it's unorganized. Mothers can find ourselves in a place of waiting, waiting to be heard, waiting to be valued, waiting to be seen, waiting to be supported, waiting to be taken seriously. Oh, the meantime is a place of waiting, and every now and then, God will orchestrate a meantime that will shake us to our core. A meantime that will cause us to question our faith and our foundation. God will interrupt our days. God will interrupt our regularly scheduled program and put us in a position that forces us to wait. We can't make the time go by any faster. We can't fill it up with enough stuff, and we don't know what to do in the meantime. The meantime, you know, the time after you lose the job, but before you get a new one and the bills keep piling up. The meantime, the time after you're admitted in rehab, but before completing the program and the addiction is calling your name. The meantime, the time after the breakup, but before your next relationship and you keep seeing him or her out with their new man or woman. The meantime, the time after God has given you the vision, but before God has given you the provision. The meantime. The time after you've raised your children, you've given them all you've got, but before they actually show a little bit of gratitude, my God, the meantime after March 2020, yet before the pandemic is over, help me, Holy Ghost, the meantime. Mothers all over this planet are familiar with the meantime, raising their children and the children of others while putting their dreams on hold. The meantime, working 2 to 3 jobs, waiting on a promotion at one so that you can quit the other. The meantime, desperate for rest, but if it's in the middle of the week and you aren't off till Saturday, the meantime can create anxiety, depression, and fear. Is there anybody in the sanctuary who knows what I'm talking about? Does there anybody know that if you aren't careful, you can lose your mind in the meantime, waiting on God to do what God said God was gonna do, praying the same prayer? God, you said you would provide. God, you said you'd give me hope. God, you said it won't always be like this. And my beloved, the meantime can force you to complain, to yell, to scream like the prophet Habakkuk in chapter 1. Oh Lord, how long must I be in the meantime? The book of Habakkuk is about the meantime. Habakkuk is the prophet. He is frustrated because he and the Israelites are experiencing a God-orchestrated meantime. In the first chapter, the prophet launches a complaint at God on the people's behalf. The Israelites had been conquered by the Assyrians first, and now the Babylonians had seized the land. And during their first attack, they took the rich and wealthy leaders, leaving the poor to fend for themselves. And then in this second attack, they destroy valuable items. They slaughtered the livestock. They stopped the food supply to starve the people. And they also desecrated the temple. The psalmist wrote, "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down and there we wept as we remembered Zion." And so Habakkuk enters into an intense yet honest dialogue with God in chapters 1 and 2. The prophet complains and God responds, but not in the way Habakkuk anticipates. And so he complains again. And what I like about the prophet is that he's not afraid to ask God why. And so Habakkuk goes back to God, and then something shifts in the text. Habakkuk in this last chapter is not complaining, but it is a prayer set to music. Habakkuk praises God for over half of chapter 3. And at the moment of our text, he says, "Though the fig tree does not bud, and though there are no grapes on the vine, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength." Habakkuk goes from complaint to resolution. He shifts from anxiety to calm. He goes from lament to a praise break. He is rejoicing because he has learned the secret to surviving in the meantime. And I would dare say to you, my beloved, that life is filled with meantime experiences. Life is filled with moments where we are waiting on God to move, waiting on change to happen. And in order to survive the meantimes in life, we need some help. And that brings me to the question, what do we do in the meantime? What do we do in the meantime? And the first thing we see in the text is that Habakkuk suggests we can rejoice in the meantime because God is able to sustain us. We can rejoice in the meantime because God is able to sustain us. It says, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. Now, the Israelites' entire economic system had hit rock bottom. They had lost everything. Look at the text. The fig trees do not bud. There are no grapes on the vine, and the olive crop has failed. These were the permanent crop, able to yield harvest for at least 5 straight years without the need to replant. Yet the text says they yielded nothing. But not only is there no permanent crop, but the annual crop has failed as well. It's in the text. It says the fields produce no food. The staple foods, the grains, the wheat, the barley, and the vegetables had failed to produce. So not only are the people suffering from a lack of permanent crop, but they are also suffering from a lack of annual crop. But the story gets worse. The text says that the livestock, the cattle and the sheep were cut off. They were scattered and destroyed. The livestock was the backup plan. When the crops failed, at least they could eat the meat of the livestock to survive. But there is no permanent crop. There is no annual crop, and there are no livestock. The people were farming people. They made their living growing crop and tending livestock. But the text says there are no permanent crop, there are no annual crop, and there are no livestock. Yet Habakkuk says, I will rejoice because the sovereign Lord is my strength. Strength doesn't just mean muscle. It's not only God's ability to move literal mountains in your life. This is strength, but the strength Habakkuk speaks of is that of God's character. His joy is grounded in God's character. His joy is rooted in a God who has been there from the beginning, a God who sees all and knows all, a God whose ways are not our ways and whose thoughts are not our thoughts, a God who has parted the Red Sea, who has sent fire by day and clouds by night, a God whose character is not one that he should lie, a God who is faithful. Now, Habakkuk is not blind. He can see the fix the people were in, but he did not allow what he saw to make him doubt the God he has come to know in his own experience. Yes, he complained, but at the end of the day, he yielded to God's all-knowing power. He expressed his absolute faith in a God who can keep him and the people of Israel, no matter their circumstance. He could rejoice in the meantime because it's nobody but God that could sustain him. And I dare say to the mothers all over the planet and in the virtual space and in the sanctuary, to the black mothers and the grandmothers, to the meemaws and the mud is that you can testify to a God who has sustained you down through the years, that when your permanent crop failed, when the folks that were supposed to stick by you till death do you part, when the folks that were supposed to be with you till the end seem to up and leave you to raise the children by yourself, when the folks that claim to love you unconditionally seem to run out of love when you needed them the most, then even in the times when you can hold your head up and rejoice because the power of God sustained you in spite of whether the people stayed or left. Why? Because people are fickle. They come and go. But God can sustain you whether you got a lot of people around you or you ain't got nobody. And when your annual crop fails, when the job lays you off, when your health seems to fail, when your dreams go unfulfilled, The same God that could keep you, can keep you. The same God that clothed the lilies and feed the ravens can still clothe you and feed you. The same God that has healed back then is the God that can heal right now. And in the meantime, when your cattle has been destroyed, when your last resort fails, when you ain't got no backup plan, when you've run out of options, black mothers know when we're running out of options, when you've done all you can do, you can still rejoice because you serve a God who knows the plans he has for you, plans to prosper you, plans to not harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. And so you can say, though the justice system seems slow, God is my sustainer. Though we're still in a pandemic, God is my sustainer. Though the powers that be are systematically eliminating the black race, God is my sustainer. Though I got more bills than money, God is my sustainer. Though I'm sleeping with the enemy, catch that on the way home, God is my sustainer. You can say, though, dot, 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 God is my sustainer. How do you know, preacher? Because my grandmother used to testify about this God. Because my mother still testifies about that God. But I can do you better than that. I've come to know God for myself. And I can tell you that God is El Shaddai, God Almighty. God is Jehovah Shammah, the Lord that is present. God is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who provides. God is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. God is Jehovah Nisi. He is my banner. My grandma says he's a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. He's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And so we can rejoice in the meantime, because it is God who will sustain us. Not only can we rejoice in the meantime, because God is our sustainer, but Habakkuk suggests we can rejoice in the meantime because God has designed us to be overcomers. God has designed us to be overcomers. It's in verse 19. He says, he makes my feet like the feet of deer. He enables me to tread on the heights. Now, if you've seen a deer run, you might be fooled into thinking that the secret is in his legs. But the truth of the matter is that the deer's ability to leap 8-foot fences without losing his balance or climb rough mountains is in the design of his feet. It's not the power nor the speed of the deer, but the design of the deer's feet. Can I tell you about the deer's feet? On wet and soft surfaces, a deer's feet are designed to absorb the shock of every stride, which gives it traction to keep it from slipping. On hard surfaces, a deer's feet are softer on the inside, which provides cushions to sustain it on rough terrain. On worn out surfaces, a deer's feet are sharp on the outside, which allows it to dig into the soil to gain traction while running. And in the deep mud or snow, the deer has the ability to broaden its platform, giving it traction to pull itself out of the mud. The design of the deer's feet allow it to escape their enemies. The deer's feet can move swiftly out of harm's way. The deer's feet are designed such that it can overcome any terrain it finds itself on. Habakkuk says, he makes my feet like the feet of deer. The Lord makes our feet like the feet of deer, meaning God has given us what we need to make this journey called life. That should shout you. God has designed us to be able to overcome no matter the place places we find ourselves in, no matter the mean times we find ourselves in. So when you find yourself on soft or wet surfaces, places that can make you slip, addictions that may be calling your name, unhealthy coping mechanisms, tempting places, situations that seek to compromise your integrity, easy ways out, situations that can get you into trouble, people who know your triggers, people who use your weakness for their advantage, know that you can overcome it because God has placed in you the ability to slow down and proceed with caution. God has given you mother wit or intuition, the ability to see people and situations just as they are and adjust yourself accordingly. When you find yourself in hard places, fallow ground, places that are stubborn, that won't move, places like this pandemic, places like trying to convince folk that Black Lives Matter, places like watching your sons and daughters die too soon, places like waiting for justice and equity, places like living from paycheck to paycheck, places like not knowing how you're gonna feed your children, God has given us fortitude and resolve to keep pressing. Keep believing, keep protesting, keep speaking truth to power, keep moving forward in faith, no matter how hard it might be. And when you find yourself in worn out places, places that are worn out from constant use, the same family issues, same justice issues, same church issues, same education issues, when you find yourself repeating yourself over and over again, and it seems like nobody's listening, stay the course, because God has given you staying power. And sometimes you got to keep saying it in order for folks to change. When you find yourself in the deep mud or snow, places that drain you, places that seem to slow you down and almost paralyze you, people that don't want to see you grow, people that don't want to see you progress, know that God has given you the ability to pull yourself out of there. God has given you wisdom to ask for help. I'm trying to help somebody. God has given us therapy, help me Holy Ghost, to help you work your way through that stuff. And so, my beloved, we can rejoice in the meantime because God has designed us to overcome. This is the testimony of Black folks, that we are overcomers, that somehow we made it. The middle passage didn't take us out. Slavery didn't take us out. Jim Crow didn't take us out. Mass incarceration didn't take us out. Lack of access didn't take us out. And the pandemic hasn't taken us out. And so, my beloved, we are designed to overcome. My grandmother, Lillian Travis, was an easygoing woman. She didn't seem to get riled up about anything. And while she was alive, I would ask her, Grandma, how did you do it? And she said, Christy, I'm seasoned in this thing. I'm not new to this thing. I've seen the worst of people, and I've seen the best of people. And I've learned that trouble don't last always, that seasons change. And if you hold on a little while longer, the storm will pass. And I don't know what surface you found yourself on today, but I will tell you like my grandmama told me, trouble don't last always. The storm will pass. And if you don't know it, keep living a little while longer. As I take my seat this morning, my brothers and sisters, there's another mean time that I can recall. It was the 400 years. They call it the silent years between the Old Testament and the New Testament. For 400 years, some say God was silent and that the people were living in the meantime. They were waiting on God to show up. They were waiting on God to send a king to vindicate God's people. And the Bible declares that when the time had fully come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. In other words, the time of Jesus' birth was God's appointed hour, the moment for which God had been long preparing. The meantime was where God was working things out for our good. And I want to encourage the mothers. I want to let them know that God is always working in the meantime. God sees you in the meantime. God is preparing you in the meantime. God is keeping you in the meantime. God is still speaking to you in the meantime. God is making a way in the meantime. But whatever happens in the meantime, everything is going to be all right. No matter what happens in the meantime, everything is going to be all right. Have you any rivers that seem uncrossable? Have you any mountains you cannot tunnel through? Well, I know a God who specializes in the meantime, and he'll do what no other power can do. Have you any affliction that seems incurable? The doctors have done all they can do, but I know a God who specializes in things that are impossible. He'll do what no other power, Holy Ghost power, can do. He'll do what no other power, Holy Ghost power, will do. Have you any rivers that seem uncrossable? Have you any mountains you cannot tunnel through? God specializes in things impossible, and he'll do what no other power will do. Have you any afflictions that seem incurable? The doctors have done all they can do. God specializes in things impossible, and he'll do what no other power, Holy Ghost power, can do. The doors of the church are now open. And I don't know where you find yourself today. I don't know if you find yourself in the meantime, even in the sanctuary and even in the virtual space. I don't know where you find yourself. But what I do know is that God sees you wherever you are. God sees you in this meantime. And you have a community of people right here in this sanctuary and even virtually that could walk with you on this journey. And so if you have not had or do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and you want to respond to the message by saying, yes, Lord, here I am, here I am, we're here. If you need to do that in the chat, you're more than welcome to do that in the chat. The door of the church is open during the week, and you can call and say, hey, I saw your telecast. I want to be part of that ministry. I want to be a part of that ministry. I want to serve at Metropolitan Baptist Church. Will you have me? Yes, we will. Yes, we will. Yes, we will.
Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Come on, we can do better than that. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise as we thank God for the word of God that has gone forth on this day in the meantime. And we are living in the meantime, but the Lord continues to bless us and watch over us. As the doors of the church are open, as our First Lady has stated, there may be somebody out there worshiping with us virtually or in person who desires a closer relationship with the Lord. If that's you today, we invite you to make yourselves known in the chat. We invite you to contact us at our church office, DM us on Facebook, whatever way you can reach out to us. please do so, so that we might wrap our arms around you. Yes, this is a time we're living outside of our comfort zone, but we know and believe that our God is still able to meet us at our point of need. And so as our doors are open today, we encourage you, don't go another minute, don't go another day without making sure that you're rooted and planted somewhere where you can grow and thrive. These are times where we need to be rooted. These are times where we don't need to play with God, but rather we need a solid foundation. Come on, somebody. So as the storms come and as life happens, we'll be anchored in God. And so if there's somebody out there who desires to be planted and rooted right here at the Metropolitan Baptist Church, where we believe that extra effort wins, I invite you to reach out to us so that we might be able to wrap our arms around you. Let us pray. Oh, gracious and all wise God, we thank you for the powerful word that has gone forth on today. God, we thank you for this vessel in Dr. Christie. God, we thank you for how she is evidence, oh Lord, that you are still calling your daughters to preach. Oh God, we thank you today. And we pray that, Lord, even as a result of her faithfulness and how she's poured in to our mothers on today, that, Lord, you might bless her. God, give her the desires of her heart. Open doors for her. Give her the support that she needs as she continues to serve you. Bless her, oh God, as she serves at the seminary. God, bless her even as she continues to serve right here at this place. It's in Christ's name we do pray. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Now it's offering time, my brothers and sisters. And here at the Metropolitan Church, we believe in giving in three ways. We give in a way that is prayerful. Well, we ask God to guide us in our giving. We give in a way that is generous. Well, we model God-like behavior because we know that the Lord is very generous unto us. Each and every day, God is showing us just how good God is to us. But not only that, we are joyous when we give because we get excited about what God is going to do as a result of our gifts and as a result of our giving. That God is going to help for us to expand and enlarge our territory. And what that means for us is that we're able to encourage other people to be able to hold out in the meantime. We're able to help other people to be rooted and planted so that they can grow in grace. And not only that, but we're excited about the fact that we know that God will bless us as a result of our faithfulness. Anybody know that God is faithful? Anybody know that God is a keeper? And when you trust God, the Lord will surely bless you. And so we're getting ready to give now. As we prepare now to give, for those of us who are in the sanctuary or even worshiping with us virtually, you can give in several different ways. You can give by dropping off your gifts each and every Friday to our church located right here at 767 Walker Avenue, right in the heart of South Memphis. You can send your gifts securely to our P.O. Box, P.O. Box 262, Memphis, Tennessee, 38101. You can also give your gifts electronically via Givelify or PayPal. And both of those links are located on our website, www.extraeffortwins.org. And so, for those of us who are gathered here today, you can also give your gifts as our ushers will come through and collect our tithes and offerings at this time. We will now pray and bless our offering, and then we will move forward with our giving. Let us bow for a word of prayer. Oh God, we thank you for each and every gift, and we thank you for each and every giver. God, bless us no matter where we are, as we seek to allow what you've entrusted unto us to be used for the uplifting of your kingdom. It's in Christ's name we do pray. And all of the saints of God said amen, amen, and amen. Quiet.